Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Better Business, How the B Corp Movement is Remaking Capitalism, by Christopher Marquis, narrated by Christopher Grove. Preface. The B Corp Movement is the most important social movement you've never heard of. If you care about rising inequality and decreasing economic mobility, the climate crisis, the coming soil and water crisis, and the political crisis of tribalism, then you should care about the B Corp movement. If you care about long-term economic growth as well as the future of high-quality jobs and work itself in an age of mass automation, then you need to know more about it. Founded by a nonprofit called B Lab, the B Corp movement is focused on creating a new kind of company that has a triple bottom line: people, planet, and profits, baked into its DNA. At the center of this work is a rigorous assessment whereby companies' performance is judged not just on earnings, but on contribution to society and the environment. Thousands of companies around the globe have undergone this assessment. These B corporations take responsibility for how they affect every one of their stakeholders, not just those who own shares. Over the last 15 years, as a professor of business administration at Harvard and Cornell, I have engaged directly with the next generation of business and civic leaders, the people who will shape the economy of tomorrow. At Harvard Business School, HBS, I taught courses on social innovation and institutional change. When I was out giving talks or consulting with companies, I would frequently be asked to name the most impressive examples of business innovation I had seen. I always had a few choice answers, things that had recently caught my interest or impressed me. But since 2009, my answer to this question has consistently been the B Corp movement. At first, most of the people I talked to would reply, "Huh?" Now I am more likely to get nods of recognition. The B Corp movement is picking up steam, and business leaders, particularly those concerned about sustainability, are taking notice. Firms in the food and beverage industry might have heard that the Paris-based multinational food products company, Danone, committed to becoming a B Corp. In the apparel world, well-known brands like Patagonia and Eileen Fisher have long been certified B Corps and active supporters of the movement. But the full scope of the movement and its potential impact are still not fully appreciated. Most business leaders still regard B Corp companies as occupying a niche at the fringe of their industries, as cute social enterprises that could never truly succeed. Those assumptions are wrong. The B Corp movement has grown exponentially in just its first decade, and I believe that it and associated ideas are poised to be a catalyst for reforming our capitalist economy. To understand this shift, we need to have a systematic understanding of the movement's breadth and scope, including its dynamics and history. The stories of B corporations in this book illustrate how and why their certification can make a fundamental difference to their business operations in the future. But it's important to note that the movement is about much more than the number of certified B corporations. In the last decade, the team at B Lab has created innovative tools for assessing companies and built networks to encourage the growth of the movement. In addition to Danone, B Lab has grabbed the attention of multinational corporations such as Unilever, Procter & Gamble, Nestle, and Gap, as well as many of the most innovative companies founded in the last decade, including Kickstarter, Allbirds, Casper, and Bombas. In interacting with hundreds of executives at scores of social businesses like these, I have found that they are spearheading a social movement. They are interested in promoting not just their own business ideas, but the broader notion of creating businesses that are better for all stakeholders. B Lab has also crafted a legal innovation called the Benefit Corporation that places social benefits and the rights of workers, the community, and the environment on an equal footing with the financial interests of shareholders. Political figures on both sides of the party aisle have supported the passage of legislation that establishes benefit corporations in most U.S. states. This innovation is sweeping the globe. Similar legislation has been passed in Italy, Colombia, Ecuador, and the Canadian province of British Columbia, and is under discussion in many other countries. This book tracks the way all of these different pieces have come together to create an ongoing revolution. My interest in the movement was sparked in the spring of 2009, when I was teaching a course at HBS on how large companies such as IBM, Goldman Sachs, and Timberland could be strategic in their corporate social responsibility CSR programs. One day, a student commented that if we wanted to learn about true innovation in the area, we should not study the CSR programs of large companies, but examine how social values can be more fundamentally embedded in a company's DNA. Unclear on what she meant, I asked her to elaborate, and she described what a B Corp was and listed several certified B corporations that I knew well, including Method Home Products, King Arthur Flour, and the Boston-based social investment pioneer Trillium Asset Management. I was a bit embarrassed that I had never heard of B Corps until that day, so I spent some time researching the movement. The information I found online reeled me in, but I still wanted to know more. I got in touch with the founders of B-Lab, and in 2010 I published the first in-depth case study of their work. Since then, my colleagues and I have researched and published more than 50 Harvard case studies on social innovation, increasingly focused on B corporations and the movement they are creating. My earliest accounts of B corporations were written before I had grasped the full breadth of the movement. In 2011, a student class project introduced me to Sweet Riot, an all-natural, women-owned chocolate company with innovative supplier practices that produces delicious nibs, small pieces of crushed cacao beans covered in chocolate. When I visited the company's headquarters in Greenwich Village to interview its leaders, I was surprised to see a B Corp certificate hanging on the wall. A year later, a research assistant's passion about Warby Parker's eyewear and its buy one, give one donation model convinced me that it was an important company to study. Again, a visit to its corporate headquarters revealed to me that Warby Parker was a certified B Corp. For reasons that I will describe later, it no longer is. Clearly, my millennial students and researchers were seeing a bigger picture that had not yet come into focus for me. The change I've witnessed over just a decade has been incredible. In 2009, just a handful of pioneering students knew about B Corps. Today, when I begin the first class of the course I teach on social entrepreneurship at Cornell, I ask my students to raise their hands if they've heard of the movement, and nearly everyone's hand shoots up. More important, however, is how deeply passionate they are about the project and how much they want to be involved. Every year since 2010, I've invited B-Lab leaders to visit my classes and sponsored campus events to discuss their work. Disappointingly, the first such event attracted only a handful of students. Since 2016, however, some of these events have been standing room only in spaces that hold more than 100 people. Students sit on the steps and crowd in the doorways to hear what the B-Lab founders have to say. I have learned as much from my students about the importance of developing this new way of doing business as I have taught them. Millennials make up approximately half of the workforce already, and over the next few decades, as their boomer parents pass on, it is estimated that they will inherit $30 trillion. They have a significant desire to create positive change through their purchases and work, and the B Corp movement is capable of delivering this. As consumers, voters, and future leaders, they will be the vanguard that drives it forward, though it will take all generations, all people, to really make it happen. It is important to recognize that this movement is truly global. More than 50% of B Corps are outside the United States. My first personal experience with how widespread this movement had become was in China in 2014. I had been invited to give a presentation on corporate social responsibility to the inaugural class of the Peking University Master of Social Enterprise Management program. I assumed that these students would want to see recognizable names, so I reverted to my examples of Goldman Sachs and IBM, while also adding a few Chinese examples. After my presentation, a student leader politely let me know that many of them were disappointed that I hadn't discussed B corporations. They had seen from my resume that I'd been researching this subject and hoped I'd be presenting on it. Impressed, I told her to ask the program advisor to invite me to return to give a presentation on B Corps. A few months later, I returned to Beijing to deliver a public lecture on the B Corp movement attended by local Chinese entrepreneurs as well as interested students. This brought my work to the attention of social enterprise leaders in Hong Kong, and in November 2017, I was a keynote speaker at the Hong Kong Social Enterprise Summit, which had over 4,000 attendees. I had been invited specifically because of my focus on B Corps. I spoke right after Hong Kong's chief executive, Carrie Lam. In 2017, I researched and published a Harvard Kennedy School case study on First Respond, the first certified B Corp in mainland China. Then in February 2018, I was one of 12 global academics, including Nobel Prize-winning economist Edmund Phelps, who were chosen to brief Chinese Prime Minister Li Keqiang on key changes in the world that China should understand and adapt to. While I was asked to speak on social entrepreneurship and innovation generally, I spent about a third of my 20 minutes on the potential of the B Corp movement for China. China's B Corp movement is still in its infancy, but the drive and passion are there. The organizers must have found the topic interesting, as I was invited to participate in this gathering in 2019 and 2020. In January 2020, right before China's coronavirus lockdown, I met the Prime Minister in Beijing again and presented to his team on many of the key ideas in this book. Little did I know that, only months later, the world would be in a different place, and the ideas in this book would be even more important. In addition to my students and the social entrepreneurs who are founding B Corps, I have also been energized by growing enthusiasm from a third set of actors, regular people who believe that there should be change in this country and want to know more about the B Corp movement. When I teach executives or talk with friends and colleagues about B Corps, many express surprise that they had not already heard of it. Once awareness kicks in, they begin to see such companies everywhere. Even a decade into my work on this topic, I am surprised and inspired almost every day by the number of B corporations I come across. Not long ago, as I was having dinner in a restaurant a few blocks from my apartment in New York City, I ordered a bottle of wine from the biodynamic French vintner Chateau Maris. The wine was delicious, but I wasn't expecting the B Corp logo prominently displayed on the back of the bottle. Chateau Maris became certified in 2016, the first winery in Europe to do so. Robert Eden, founder of Chateau Maris, explained why a French winery would want to receive a U.S.-based certification. B Corp is a great roadmap to entice us and encourage us to take steps within our company to open up more to social and environmental aspects. It also allows us to put in place certain management tools so we become more precise and more accurate in achieving our goals. It opens up many doors that we didn't know were there. The vineyard works at improving its supplier chain, using biodynamic methods in agriculture and improving the local community, while also making great-tasting wine. All of these experiences tell me that the B Corp movement is poised to break out. Tipping points typically occur after a change has been percolating under the surface for a while and has not yet been fully recognized. At some point, an event connects the dots and leads to greater awareness and a steeper growth trajectory. I certainly hope that this book will play a part in that. Introduction. Many people, especially young people, deeply distrust our current system of capitalism. They have good reason to. Despite the astounding technological innovations it has enabled, only some people have benefited. Though a host of indicators tell us that the economy is strong, vast numbers of people struggle to pay for basic provisions such as food and shelter. When the economy falters, average people see that the rich stay rich and the rest bear the brunt. Lots of smart young people are unable to find jobs that suit their talents. Further education might help them, but many can't afford it. If that isn't enough, they can see that the climate is changing and that much of the business world is loath to admit and address its capability in that phenomenon. Hurricanes Irma, Maria, and Harvey physically devastated parts of North America, creating long-term economic damage. Heat waves in Pakistan and tsunamis in Indonesia, among many other natural disasters, have left thousands dead and homeless. California businessman Paul Hawken, the co-founder of the gardening retailer Smith & Hawken, put it this way: "We are stealing the future, selling it in the present, and calling it GDP. What does that mean? It means that the industrial world is built by sleight of hand. Companies don't have to pay for the damage their pollution creates, but if those costs were factored into their operations, they would be losing money. In fact, research has shown that if we took their environmental impacts into account, none of the top industry sectors would be profitable. Furthermore, the corporate world has been rife with scandals. Companies have been exposed for the ways in which they disregard not only environmental, but also human costs. Uber and the Weinstein Company, among many others, have been called out for allowing a culture of sexism and harassment to thrive at their companies. HSBC Bank in the United Kingdom was exposed for paying men twice as much as women, and pay inequality exists in virtually every industry across the globe. It isn't hard to figure out how companies benefit from ignoring a culture of harassment or from offering less pay to those who have been conditioned not to ask for more than they're given. These are the direct consequences of shareholder primacy, a focus on maximizing profits and share values to the exclusion of equity and fairness. Under the banner of serving shareholders first, businesses have compartmentalized their liabilities. Typically, costs that are outside of a company's immediate purview, for example, the quality of air in the towns in which they operate, the healthcare costs of their employees, are considered externalities. Economic theory, based on shareholder primacy, says that corporations should limit the cost of externalities to return more money to shareholders. But this has led us to the crucial tipping point that we find ourselves at today. This is brought into relief by the U.S. healthcare industry response to the coronavirus pandemic. To reduce costs, vital equipment such as facial masks and ventilators are produced just in time, and offshoring and outsourcing is rampant. The result is a fragile system that can't deal well with crises. It is key now for us to think not about externalities, but about interdependencies. To understand that companies, communities, consumers, employees, and the planet itself are all intimately connected. Every decision made by one actor in this web directly affects all of the others. Historically, governments addressed these issues, developing policies and programs to hold companies accountable. Today, they are not only pulling back from regulation, they are enacting destructive policies themselves. The Trump administration's environmental irresponsibility and tax cutting dominate the headlines, but this has been happening all over the world. At some point, someone will have to pay. It may not be the generation in power today, but it will likely be the next one, and they aren't happy about it. Capitalism, as we've known it for the last half century, with its overwhelming focus on shareholder primacy, must become a thing of the past. Luckily, not all businesses are motivated by unchecked greed. A growing number of companies are working to secure a higher quality of life for everyone, not just the rich, to steer us away from our impending fall off the environmental and societal cliff. More than 3,000 of them all over the world, including many that make products we consume and use every day, have been certified by B Lab. The B Corp movement that they are creating is one in which businesses recognize that they can only truly thrive when they benefit everyone who is affected by their operations. The B Corp movement is, in large part, a direct response to the toxic workplace cultures, poor environmental standards, and profit-centered mindsets that have long dominated the corporate world. It is a grassroots movement that began from the bottom and is working its way to the top, alongside a number of other movements and organizations that share a similar spirit. Among them, Virgin Group founder Richard Branson's B Team and Whole Foods CEO John Mackey's Conscious Capitalism. B Corps have also been actively involved in Pope Francis's Economy of Francesco, which aims to make the economy of today and tomorrow fair, sustainable, and inclusive, with no one left behind. In December 2019, over 500 B Corps publicly committed at the UN Climate Change Conference, COP25, to accelerate the reduction of their greenhouse gas emissions to reach net zero by year 2030, a full 20 years ahead of the 2050 targets set in the Paris Agreement. B Lab also recently joined forces with the United Nations to help operationalize its 17 Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, for business. Among the thousands of certified B corporations are independent firms like Patagonia, business units of multinational corporations like Campbell's Soup and Gap, and startups such as Kickstarter. In the United Kingdom, leading media company The Guardian Media Group, publisher of The Guardian and The Observer, was certified in 2019. And in South America, Natura, a publicly traded $3 billion cosmetics company that recently acquired U.S. beauty industry pioneer Avon, and Triciclos, a recycling company, are also driving changes in the mindsets of employees, investors, consumers, and governments. In addition to its certification process, B Lab has been working to create a new corporate form that formalizes social responsibility in companies' governance. 35 American states have passed benefit corporation legislation as of early 2020, and more than 10,000 U.S. companies have incorporated using the benefit corporation form. Benefit corporation legislation has already passed in Italy, Colombia, Ecuador, and British Columbia. Argentina, Australia, Brazil, Canada, Chile, and France are among the countries that are currently working to enact it. This book is about much more than just the B Corp movement. It tracks the evolution of the principles and practices developed by B Lab and others in order to understand why they are necessary, to highlight how they work in practice, and to encourage others to join this movement to reform capitalism. While individually, what are known as social businesses create important impacts, the traditional conception of them as a fourth sector assumes that the rest of capitalism should maintain its current way of thinking. What's needed, and what the B Corp movement represents, is a fundamentally new way of doing business. B Lab got the movement going, but to transform capitalism, we all need to be completely on board. Companies must adhere to higher standards and work to increase their positive impacts. Consumers must use their everyday purchases to choose the type of world they want to live in. Employees must demand more of their employers and, in turn, be passionate and dedicated themselves to sustainable practices. Investors, especially those in the public markets, must hold companies to a rigorous and all-encompassing standard. Policymakers must actively enact change through the policies and statutes they support. Citizens must speak up with their votes. The system cannot change itself. Only we can. Although it is not usually thought of as a social business, Paris-based Danone has been a pioneer in this space. Its global CEO, Emmanuel Faber, saw the B Corp movement as revolutionary and jumped on board. As of early 2020, Danone has 17 certified B Corps in its corporate portfolio, including its North American subsidiary. As Faber told me, becoming a B Corporation gave Danone an ability to say, "This is the kind of company we are. More and more companies should be like that." Founded in 1973 by Fred Keller, Cascade Engineering, a large plastics manufacturing company headquartered in Grand Rapids, Michigan, has been an equal opportunity employer since its very first day and worked with other companies in Michigan to combat racism. Christina Keller, Fred Keller's daughter and Cascade's current CEO, describes the company's triple bottom line. "We don't take a hierarchical approach to people. Everybody has value." She emphasizes, "It's not good enough to say, 'Hey, you're valued.' The company actively helps formerly incarcerated and people on welfare to reestablish careers." She continues, "Care for the planet was a big part of our upbringing, and now that translates into recycled materials, zero waste to landfill, etc., in the facility. And then on the profit side, how can we be the most effective that we can be? How can we figure out how to solve problems?" Fred Keller teaches a course at Cornell University on sustainable business, and when he met the B-Lab founders, he knew he wanted to support the movement. As Christina Keller explains, "Our values have always been there. We became a B Corp to help push the movement forward, and push it in a new way, and attract or come together with others that have similar values. It's not as if we put the B on and started doing anything differently. This was kind of an additional certification to help us look at how we can get better and connect with a greater community." There is an important distinction between being a B Corporation and other forms of socially focused corporate activities, such as donating to nonprofits and implementing recycling plans. Corporate social responsibility, CSR, a business approach that encourages sustainability in the behaviors of corporations, has been around for quite some time. On the surface, these ideas are certainly laudable. However, many companies and their leaders have been accused of greenwashing, that is, of being all talk and no action. They publicize their green work, whether that be environmental initiatives or social ones, while hiding the true costs of their business. For instance, for many years, BP was investing in alternative energy and claiming its two-letter name stood for Beyond Petroleum. In 2000, to reflect this new image, the company changed its logo from the traditional shield with BP in the middle to a green and yellow sunflower design. Then in 2010, the Deepwater Horizon oil spill occurred, and the public learned that BP's internal practices did not match its public relations. The environmental and human cost of the oil spill was devastating. The explosion itself cost 11 people their lives, and direct exposure to the fumes that arose when the platform exploded or from the spill itself could lead to long-term skin and respiratory issues. The animal life in the area has yet to recover. In 2017, 7 years after the spill occurred, a local fisherman described the long-term effects. "I saw a fish this summer that still had spinal deformities. Speckled trout born with kinks in their spines. I've seen bottlenose dolphins with big blotches on them. That's not normal." For a long time, seafood from this area was toxic. Perhaps the most considerable human cost was economic. Many industries were affected, from fishing to tourism. How can consumers, employees, and others tell the difference between companies that are truly doing good and those that are all talk? If we are ever to trust corporations again, their first step must be toward greater transparency and accountability. Those issues cut to the core of the BP case. In 2018, BP announced a renewed focus on cutting emissions from its oil and gas rigs, certainly a laudable goal at first glance. However, it continued to ignore the much bigger contributions to global warming that its actual products, oil and gas, make. Critics such as Tom Burke, the chairman of environmental think tank E3G and a former BP advisor, labeled this a 20th century response to a 21st century problem. Consumers need to be able to look beyond the logo and understand how green and well-run a company's operations actually are at the core, not just through side projects or public relations. I witnessed this confusion firsthand on a recent trip with family and friends in Boulder, Colorado. I had explained my research on the B Corporation movement, which most of them had never heard of. That evening, as we walked in an outdoor retail area, they were amazed as I pointed out the B Corp's companies, including Patagonia, Ben & Jerry's, Athleta, an athletic wear brand owned by Gap that had the B Corp logo prominently displayed on its front window, and locally owned Newton Running. Interestingly, one of my friends asked about Lush Cosmetics, expecting it to be on the list of B Corps that I was rattling off. Why have some brands that portray a socially responsible image not joined the movement? Although I couldn't be sure, I suspected that Lush's use of chemicals at the time, which the company had been criticized for, might be one of the reasons. The company's use of plastic packaging, despite the farmer's market look of the store, might also be holding it back from meeting B Lab's standards. At the bottom of Lush's website, where many companies feature certification badges attesting that their products are fair trade, organic, and/or cruelty-free, Lush lists a series of terms that bear a striking resemblance to certification badges: fighting animal testing, ethical buying, 100% vegetarian, handmade, and naked packaging. Exploring these various claims leads to stories from the company itself, but not much in terms of third-party certifications or audits. While recent press releases do suggest that Lush may be doing a lot of good work in eliminating chemicals and wasteful packaging, without a rigorous third-party assessment, it is difficult to judge the veracity of the company's claims. My friends and family realized that the B Corp brand is an incredibly powerful tool to easily and reliably identify socially responsible businesses. Two important features set companies like Danone North America and Cascade Engineering apart from other responsible or conscious businesses. First, as noted, is that they have undergone a rigorous assessment of their activities and are transparent to the public about the results. People can see and judge for themselves the company's actions. Second is that they have changed their governance, incorporating a social mission into the legal foundation of the company, recognizing that the company is deeply interdependent with society. This new version of business and the economy can provide the foundation for a better, more equitable and sustainable form of capitalism. This movement has become international. It has spread to all four corners of the world, is embraced by local entrepreneurs, and has been met with excitement and passion in every country it's made landfall in. Truly, full global expansion is the only way for this movement to push our economy past the tipping point to a more sustainable form of capitalism. While businesses can't solve every problem we face, they have a big role to play in a capitalist society. They can continue to tip the scales toward the benefit of the few, with toxic side effects for all, or they can guide us toward better, more equitable long-term solutions. In today's political and social environment, such a shift is more important than ever, and it is happening. Millennials are largely driving this change through their preference, as consumers and as workers, for companies that challenge the mainstream and are socially and environmentally responsible. The B Corp movement not only provides a framework to do this, but is also a rallying point for others to get behind. In 2017, the business world was taken aback when the UK-based consumer goods company Unilever rejected a $143 billion bid by Kraft Heinz. The bid was backed by the major shareholders of Kraft Heinz, Berkshire Hathaway, owned by the world's best-known capitalist, Warren Buffett, and the Brazilian private equity firm 3G Capital. According to everything we know about capitalism, the bid should have been accepted because it would have enriched Unilever shareholders. But it wasn't. Why? Because the battle between the power of traditional capitalism, focused solely on business profit to the exclusion of all else, and the need to recognize that companies and society are deeply linked, had come to a head. Unilever's CEO at the time, Paul Polman, described the failed bid as a clash between people who think about billions of people in the world and some people that think about a few billionaires. On one side stood Buffett, whose many famous investments include the classic American brands Coca-Cola, Dairy Queen, and McDonald's. While Buffett's down-to-earth lifestyle is as lauded as his investment acumen, he still lives in the Omaha house he bought in 1958 and eats breakfast every day at McDonald's, despite his constantly increasing wealth. His choice to associate himself with fast food companies appears increasingly inconsistent with the sustainability-focused values of today's young consumers. On the other side stood Polman, a self-effacing corporate statesman who preferred to make investments in socially responsible businesses, including such well-known brands as Seventh Generation and Ben & Jerry's, and lesser-known ones such as Pucker Herbs, Mayterra, Sir Kensington's, and Sundial, all of them certified B corporations that develop natural and organic products. Polman is not a naive man. He understood the strategic value of positioning his company to better meet the needs and interests of the next generation. Under his leadership, Unilever's guiding mission was to follow responsible business practices and to prioritize the needs of all stakeholders, which includes you, me, and everyone else on the planet. As Polman put it, "I don't think our fiduciary duty is to put shareholders first. I say the opposite." Unilever strives to focus on improving the lives of the world's citizens and come up with genuine sustainable solutions. And this mindset is rooted in the company's belief that being in sync with consumers and society will ultimately lead to favorable shareholder returns. A stronger reputation among consumers, better employee retention, environmentally sound practices, and healthy profits. This is the new capitalism built on interdependencies. This new way of doing business is evolving capitalism from a 20th century model of wealth maximization for shareholders to a new system that maximizes value for society. Many people questioned the wisdom of Unilever's decision when it rejected the Kraft Heinz bid, and the company may continue to face risks because of it. But so far, the numbers are on Unilever's side. The company's sustainable living brands have been outperforming its other brands for several years. They grew 46% faster than the rest of its business in 2017, fueling most of its sales growth. Polman knew that Berkshire Hathaway and 3G Capital focus on generating short-term value and often implement intensive cost-cutting measures in the companies they acquire. That might mean employees losing their jobs, environmental programs facing the chopping block, and long-term sustainability initiatives getting stuck in neutral. The potential loss of anything and everything that doesn't translate into short-term profit. Rejecting the bid was a not-so-quiet moment of revolt against shareholder primacy. However, I see this example mainly as a leading indicator that there is another way to do business. Buffett and Pullman personify the fundamental difference between two types of corporate cultures that are now very clearly opposing each other. On one side is traditional business, with its exclusive focus on shareholders' profit and short-term returns. On the other is business with a triple bottom line: people, planet, and profit. Companies like Unilever are at the forefront of redefining capitalism, and young people and their day-to-day choices are helping them do it. But creating a sustainable business model is only the first step. Without concomitant legal changes, those well-intentioned changes could wither over time as companies take on new management and investors. Indeed, Pullman has since retired from Unilever. It remains to be seen whether the company will continue on the course he set for it. Across many industries, challenger brands that have embraced the triple bottom line are redefining what it means to be a company in the 21st century. Method and Seventh Generation, for example, have challenged the chemical-based cleaning and home product industry by providing natural, non-toxic, and biodegradable products. The success of both brands can be attributed to the growing consumer consciousness of toxic chemicals and their effects on the environment, as well as the company's risk-taking attitude in standing up to traditional mainstream corporations. As we've seen, people feel that the current system is flawed, and it's failing them. 40% of America's wealth is in the hands of just 1% of the population. Carbon in our atmosphere has surpassed the 400 parts per million that is widely considered dangerous. Legal structures hinder long-term value creation for shareholders and stakeholders alike, while a lack of standards makes it difficult for consumers, investors, policymakers, and workers to distinguish good companies from good marketing. The growing movement of people who seek to use business to address these challenges is one of the most important social trends of our time. Tens of millions of consumers, investors, and workers are seeking to align their purchases, investments, and employment decisions with their values. Millennials want more than just a paycheck. Studies show they want a higher purpose and a connection to the social values of the companies they choose to work for, and that they generally reject the traditional singular goal of capitalism: maximizing profits. The rise of B Corps is a clear indication of this trend. 2/3 of millennials shared that the reason they accepted a job offer was the mission of their company. Many B Corps have stated that they notice an uptick in recruitment post-certification, and that many new applicants credit their B Corp certification as the reason they're applying. A 2019 Deloitte study showed that most college-educated millennials believe that the primary purpose of business should be to act as a force for good, to improve the world. However, fewer than half of the millennials surveyed said that businesses behave ethically. Millennials and Gen Zers are losing faith in the current system and its leadership for a myriad of reasons, and they are attracted to socially responsible businesses that take care of their employees. Market research confirms that millennials are much more conscious than older generations about the products and businesses they endorse through their consumption. A recent survey conducted by the Harvard Kennedy School found that more than 50% of people between the ages of 18 and 29 reject capitalism. They want transparency and a clear understanding of the brands they consume. A Brookings Institution report found that 90% of millennials are more likely to buy from companies that support solutions to social issues than from other companies. Larry Fink, CEO of the world's largest investment firm, BlackRock, wrote in his 2019 annual letter that millennials will drive not only their decisions as employees, but also as investors, with the world undergoing the largest transfer of wealth in history, $24 trillion from baby boomers to millennials. As this wealth shifts and investing preferences change, environmental, social, and governance issues will be increasingly material to corporate valuations. Though a new belief system is on the rise, the status quo is still protected by the old guard, men and women who do not welcome change. The first decade of the B Corp movement has not been easy, and the challenges will continue to grow until we reach the day that the movement becomes the all-encompassing success that it must. Our future is at stake, not just millennials, but everyone's. While the current global political landscape is deeply polarized, as attested by the election and subsequent years in office of President Trump and the vote leading to Brexit, among many other examples, there are also suggestions that there is significant support for progressive economic policies and a greater focus on the natural environment, even among more traditionalist and conservative segments of the U.S. population. These include a leaning toward policies for higher taxes on the rich and greater control of corporations. For instance, a 2017 Pew study showed that 94% of market-skeptic Republicans, about 30% of registered Republican voters, believe that the economy unfairly favors powerful interests and that taxes on corporations and large businesses should be raised. This view places them closer on the spectrum to liberals than conservatives. Further, a majority of the population disapproves of Trump's 2017 tax overhaul bill, which saw an incredible cut in taxes on the wealthy and on large corporations, with little relief offered to the lower and middle classes. Many self-described conservatives are taking stands on social and cultural issues, immigration, reproductive rights, LGBTQ+ rights, and fiscal issues that are more liberal than not. Awareness of the B Corp movement will grow exponentially in the coming years. Almost every day I see news reports that show its pervasiveness. For example, on one day in August 2018, a number of articles in the New York Times and other media caught my attention. One was an op-ed first published a number of months ago entitled, "No Wonder Millennials Hate Capitalism," which hardly came as a surprise to me. Indra Nooyi, the CEO of Pepsi, was stepping down from her position, and the focus of the coverage was on how she had reoriented Pepsi around healthier foods. A key example was its purchase of Bear Foods, which is a certified B Corp. Then there was a story about Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick, who had just said that President Trump should be impeached, and who at the time was rumored to be interested in running for president in 2020. Before entering the race, Patrick worked for Bain's impact investing arm. His first investment was in Sundial Brands, a B Corp, and he is a vocal supporter of B Lab's analytics platform for evaluating social investments. Around the same time, Senator Elizabeth Warren wrote an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal announcing her Accountable Capitalism Act, which would require all corporations with more than $1 billion in revenues to become federally chartered. Currently, corporate charters are at the state level in the United States and adopt a model of governance in which directors must consider the interests of all major stakeholders, not just shareholders, in company decisions. Its headline was, "Companies Shouldn't Be Accountable Only to Shareholders." As Warren acknowledges, her proposed legislation is based on the benefit corporation model pioneered by B Lab, which is already in use in Delaware, legal home to 2/3 of the Fortune 500. Before dismissing Warren's ideas as massive government overreach, as some have done, you might be interested to know that there are only about 3,800 businesses in the United States with revenues greater than $1 billion. Is it unreasonable to require them to put the interests of their workers, their customers, and their communities on par with the interests of their shareholders? Given the multiple crises we face, not least the crisis of trust, corporations are among the least trusted institutions in the United States, This doesn't seem like an irrational conversation to have as we enter into the 2020 presidential campaign and contemplate the economic forces behind such social political movements as Brexit, the Yellow Vests, and the Extinction Rebellion. On the other side of the aisle, Senator Marco Rubio recently released a 40-page report entitled American Investment in the 21st Century, in which he made the case that the American economy is suffering from an unhealthy focus on short-term financial returns. The report specifically implicates shareholder primacy theory as the main reason for the shift of American business away from the traditional role expected of it in our economy, as the theory tilts business decision-making towards returning money quickly and predictably to investors rather than building long-term corporate capabilities, reduces investment in research and innovation, and undervalues American workers' contribution to production. The Rubio report concludes, "We need to build an economy that can see past the pressure to understand value creation in narrow and short-run financial terms, and instead envision a future worth investing in for the long term." Senators Elizabeth Warren and Marco Rubio don't agree on much, but they agree on their diagnosis of the cancer that's killing American competitiveness, American communities, and American workers: shareholder primacy. Republican governors, including Nikki Haley, Mike Pence, and Scott Walker, have signed benefit corporation legislation. It is rare today to see Democrats and Republicans agree on anything, which suggests that other policies that put people rather than profits at the center of our economic decision-making could gain bipartisan support. Even CEOs of the largest American companies are starting to come to this conclusion. On August 19, 2019, the Business Roundtable, an influential trade group that represents 200 of America's largest companies, changed its statement on the purpose of a corporation to reflect that corporations should meet the needs not just of shareholders, but also those of its stakeholders, such as employees, consumers, and society. While this is an exciting development and may represent the fundamental shift in corporate ideology the world needs, the statement has come under significant critique because few details have been offered on how companies will be held accountable for implementing this new purpose. Unless these CEOs put actions behind their words, this will be just another example of business leaders giving lip service to making the world a better place while continuing to operate in the same old way. For instance, to make such statements a reality, they need to support holding companies accountable to stakeholders, begin aligning performance standards inside the firm with stakeholder-oriented objectives, and, most important, begin discussing these objectives with investors and government leaders. For wide-scale change to occur, it is essential for these leaders to convince the capital markets and policymakers of the importance of stakeholder-aligned governance structures. We are at the dawn of a new age of interdependence, but there is still much work to be done to overthrow shareholder primacy. Based on more than a decade of research and featuring interviews with leaders of dozens of leading global companies, this book explores how and why the change led by B-Lab is working. B-Lab's model focuses on accountability, performance standards, and stakeholder governance, and, as we will hear, strongly resonates with employees, even as it is gaining interest from and helping to foster the growing impact investing movement. The entrepreneurs involved are creating this change by promoting deep local networks, and the movement is rapidly spreading around the globe. As I will also show you, there are three key areas of work that are needed to help it diffuse further. First is moving from a focus on growing the number of B Corps to creating systems whereby all companies can be like B Corps. Partnering with important international initiatives, such as the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, is an important step in this direction. Furthermore, B-Lab must continue attracting larger multinationals to take their CSR to a deeper level and provide a way to change public markets to a longer-term orientation. Finally, all people, including you, the listener, need to become a part of this critical movement. Only through understanding the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.